How was the first day? Okay, I'm glad you like it. And we are about to have a poster spotlight session. So for you, for those of you who like maybe attending this first time and doesn't know, we have a row of posters that you will be able to join and see. So those are just the stands with the printed material that you will be able to look at and discuss with the authors of the posters after the this session. And during this session, we're going to have combined first half hour, we're going to have the poster spotlight sessions, which is a kind of a short presentations that our poster presenters are going to explain what their poster is about and basically invite you there. So those are just 2 minutes per poster. They have already prepared, so please be ready and like line up here with your and be ready to be near the mic. And let's get started. I'm gonna just show the name of the presenter. And once you see your name, your time has started. And once 2 minutes out, I'm gonna ask you, audience, to applaud. Does everyone understand? Yeah, cool. So let's start. So the first ones, Alexander and Piotr.
Yeah. So hello. So my name is Piotr. I'm here with Alexandra, and we have poster about our AutoML Python package. And you know, building machine learning pipeline isn't easy because you have to make a lot of choices. You need to choose the preprocessing algorithm. You need to choose the training algorithm, you need to tune hyperparameters and so on and so on. And you know, it is hard to build good machine learning pipeline. And to make it easy, we created the automated machine learning Python package, and recently we also released the web app with user interface. And so come and see the poster for more details. And if you are able to manually create a machine learning pipeline that will be better than our AutoML, I will buy you a beer. Thank you.
They had another slide, and they did it in 1 minute, so. Okay, so the next one, Ms. Milton. The floor is yours.
So, hi, my name is Milton. You can see my mug here, you can see my mug there. So, I'm going to have a poster on machine learning for earth and environmental sciences. It's a course that we developed at UNIL. All of the notebooks are available to either download in a GitHub repo or to interact with interactively, yes. But you can run them on your computer. All you need is a computer, internet access, and basic knowledge of Python. It was originally designed for environmental scientists learning to apply machine learning methods. You're going to see in the course a bunch of different libraries that you might already be familiar with, including TensorFlow, scikit-learn, PyTorch, NumPy, Pandas, matplotlib. It covers classic machine learning methods, which are especially useful as baselines, deep learning, going from artificial neural networks all the way to LSTMs and convolutional neural networks. And one of the very important points is that in it, we also do reproduction of research. So we take relatively recent research papers in earth and environmental sciences and create notebooks that reproduce their findings. And that's it.
Okay, what's your poster number? Maybe also say it. Three? Two, so please. Okay, Eric. So the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Right, hi everyone. My name is Eric. I'm a PhD student from the Department of Physics at Chalmers University of Technology in Sweden. And at my poster, I will tell you all about the Python workflow that we've developed for predicting experiments with machine learning. Why is this not? Oh, there we go. For predicting experiments with machine learning. So as a physicist, I'd say that the best tool we have for understanding the world around us are experiments. But of course, experiments can be tedious, they can be difficult, and they can be very time consuming. And as such, a workflow such as ours can help by guiding experiments to sort of which experiments you should perform. And our workflow involves three different open source packages. Two of these are Python packages that we are maintaining. The first of these is called Calorine, which helps with constructing the machine learning models. These models are then used within a simulation, and the output from this simulation can then be fed into the other package, Dinosaur, which actually predicts the experimental results. And if this is something that you find interesting, you're very happy to see me at my poster number 3. And this is how it looks like, so you don't forget. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And the next one, Johan and Lilian, please. The floor is yours. Timer's up.
Hi, everyone. So my name is Jovan Stojanovic, and this is my colleague Lilian Boulard. So we come from EuroSciPy in France. And we wanted to present with a poster a new Python package that is about to release, which is called Scrub. And it's about preparing tables for machine learning. So we realized that preparing tables for machine learning can be super complex because tables can come from various sources and they can come non-normalized. So we developed some new adapted methods that you can use for preparing them for machine learning. So we divided our poster in three parts. The first one is assembling, which concerns everything around joining, aggregating your tables. The second one is encoding, which is about how do you transform non-numerical values from your table into numerical values. So for instance, for strings or date time values. And the third part is the duplication, so it concerns data cleaning of your data. So that's all. Come to see us, and we'll be happy to hear from you. Thank you.
Poster number 4.
So, and they had another slide. Thank you. So maybe another round. Okay, Jakob, please.
Hi, everyone. My name is Jacob Tomlinson. My poster is about a tool we've been working on called Container Canary. Now, if any of you have tried to use any of your tools on other like awesome cloud platforms, right, like Azure ML or Databricks or Coiled or I don't know, other millions of other things, Binder and whatever, all of these platforms have an option where you can bring your own container along, right? They'll either say in the documentation, like, use our base image and install all your Python libraries and then use that and it will work. Or bring your own container along. Here's a random bullet point list of things that might just about get your container to work on our platform. And so I work on a bunch of projects, including Dask and others, where we provide containers for people as the project. And we want to make sure that our containers work on Binder and Azure ML and wherever, right? So we've been working on a tool inside NVIDIA called Container Canary, which is both a specification and an actual tool for defining tests for container images. So you can say, right, does it have Jupyter in it? Does it have Python in it? Does it have this library? Does it have this random user with this random user ID? And does this exist? And all the kind of assumptions these cloud platforms make. You can write that as a set of tests. And then as a project, you can provide that. As a company, you can provide that. You say, oh, we bring your own container. It should pass these tests. Or us as Dask, we can run, test our own containers against all of these platforms and do it programmatically and do it in a way that we can trust so that the platform doesn't drift and the container doesn't drift. So, yeah, come and ask me some questions at my poster. Thank you.
Okay, so the next one is Dimitros. Am I pronouncing it correctly? Okay.
Hello, my name is Dimitris, and my poster is on automating data collection and analysis in citizen science projects. The real-world application of this is understanding cell morphology in health and disease. More specifically, we are interested in being able to detect signs of cellular pathologies from electron microscopy images of cells, as you can see on the right. And an example of cell pathology is Huntington disease. And to do that, we need to be able to find where each organelle is in the electron microscopy image. And therefore, we need to do segmentation. And the purpose of my poster is to explain how we are gathering training data for doing the segmentation task. And long story short, we are heavily investing in citizen science to get our annotations done by, because this is much faster, especially if you have a lot of images to annotate. And we're using Zooniverse, which is a popular citizen science platform, an online one. And also there is some evidence that the data that you get, the training data, are more less biased when you collect with this way. So in the project, in my poster, you're going to read about the web server we have that we have created, trying to automate the image generation process and how this server is dynamically generating those images and sending them to the citizen science platform for annotation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, Lucia and Mike, please.
Hi, everyone. My name is Lucia Pedroza. I'm a PhD student at University of Freiburg, and Mike Muller from Hydro Computing. And we are presenting runtime control of numerical groundwater models. Mike will tell you a bit more about that.
Yeah, we would like you to take into the world of groundwater modeling. You might not be familiar with this. So groundwater models are big numerical models that solve PDEs, partial differential equations. And these things are typically written in Fortran, and you write a lot of input files and generate a lot of output. And sometimes you want to do something that's not possible with those models, and we have our package that allows to write a user a Python program about this size to interfere with all the variables in the model so you can get information out of the model at, for each time step, modify it, and write something back, which allows you a lot of control over this model, and that's pretty much all that, that you need to do some very complex things that would be very, very difficult with a traditional approach, maybe even impossible. So if you want to learn how to use Python to do something that would be impossible, come to our poster.
Poster number 7.
Okay. Isaac, please. The floor is yours.
Hey everyone, I'm Isaac. I'm a research software engineer at Helmholtz Munich. I'm here representing the SEverse project. So this is one of these open source consortiums that's based around doing single cell and spatial omics analysis. So on the software side, we are based around like largely these shared data structures, which have are able to store dense arrays, sparse arrays, and data frame-like data. They can also be saved with HDF5 and ZAR to disk and then be read from other languages. They're then a series of core packages that are able to create these and work with them, and then an ecosystem with hundreds of other packages that the community has built around them. My poster is going to be, come to my poster if you want to talk about biology, data formats, especially things that about sparse data formats, or if you want to talk about community building in these open source ecosystems. Thank you.
Perfect. So we have like a lot of time for lightning talks today. Jure, or Jure? Hey. Jure, please.
Hello, my name is Jure. I work at Genialis, and we're presenting a poster about how to normalize RNA-seq data. So I'm assuming that some of you don't know what RNA-seq data is. This is how it looks like in a very artificial, simplified manner. But for various samples from for example, tissues, patients, whatever, you have features which are genes. And the numbers are telling you how active a certain gene is. So to make the most of this data, you have to normalize it. And there are various methods to perform that. And they are scattered all over the place, most of them not written in Python until now. So we overview these methods, suggest which one works best in our experience. But we don't stop there. We provide you with a tool, which is a RNA norm Python package, which implements all of these most common methods. And it's written in Python, so we can operate from Python. And all these methods try to be sigkLearn compatible. So you can now put these methods as transformers into our pipeline and actually evaluate the performance of your model based on the normalization that you do. So I'll be happy to tell you more. Stop by, and we can have a chat. Thank you.
Pictures are different. OK. So the Krina AI, please.
OK. Hi, everyone. My name is Shimon, and I'm well, we all are researchers and developers and machine learning engineers from Wrocław University of Science and Technology. Long story short, during our master thesis, we worked a lot with representation learning in geospatial data, mostly with OpenStreetMap. And during that time, we identified a lot of pain points and missing like white spots in, I would say, tooling for machine learning and geospatial data. We decided it's, well, we'd like to improve it. So we decided to merge our results and create a library for working with geospatial machine learning in Python. It's open source, and we'd love to hear your feedback if you work with geospatial data or geospatial data analysis or machine learning. If you have any ideas on how to standardize the domain and improve upon what's currently there, please come to our poster. I think it's the stand number 10, and we'd love to hear. We'd love to talk about it. So yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Okay, and in total we have 15, so we are really close to the end of poster spotlight. And the next one is Vincent, please.
Hello everyone, I'm Vincent Daladier. I'm a research engineer at INRIA in Paris. I mostly work on scikit-learn, on survival analysis, and on Scrub. So come to our booth if you want to learn more about survival analysis. We build a new package called Hazardous with Olivier Grisel, which introduces a new algorithm called gradient boosting incidents. So this is basically a deep dive on the tutorial. Oh, sorry, I should pass it. There's a lag between. Okay, whatever. still not updating. I think there's a lag. Okay, sorry for that. So basically, this poster will be a deep dive on the last model we introduced during the tutorial on Monday. So if you attended to the tutorial, things should be familiar to you. If not, it will be a good occasion to learn more about survival analysis competing risk modeling events. And if you're curious about it, please feel free to come to our booth. I think we'll poster 11th, yeah, count things correctly. Thank you.
I've never seen these kind of things when slides on one screen are different from another one. Mac OS, Apple, thank you. Maria Canina. Are you here at least? Let us know. Okay, I think we have someone sick probably. Okay. So. If she's put up her poster, it's going to be about PyBAM. which is an open source Python package for battery simulation, as you can see. And if she secrets, very sorry that we don't have that speaker today. Okay. Oh, you changed the slide. Cosmic Baska, please.
Thank you. I am Cosmin. It's great to be here. I work for Oracle Labs here in Switzerland, and I work on GraalVM, specifically on GraalPy. GraalVM is essentially a Java virtual machine, a drop-in replacement for your standard Java. And GraalPy is a Java implementation of Python 3 on top of GraalVM. It bridges both ecosystems, so Java and Python. And if you have scenarios where you want to do things like number crunching in NumPy, SciPy, or other numeric-like libraries, fetch data using JDBC's driver stack from Java, or display them in Java's cross-platform UI, you can do that with GraalPy. The project is started off about 5 years ago. It's under active development. It's maturing fast. We're focusing on compatibility right now. We're tracking compatibility with hundreds of the most important Python packages, but we don't neglect performance either. For example, we're about 5x faster than C Python when executing pure Python code, and this is peak performance, not warm-up. There's a lot of goodies that GraalPy can give you. For example, Jeton compatibility mode, if you need to migrate from your Jeton project. As I said, you can access native code. You can run on GraalVM's sandbox mode for if you need to run untrusted code. There's some limitations there, but there's also benefits. Or you can create a standalone binary from your project, so battery is included, basically. It pulls in all the dependencies, and you solve your startup problem. If you want to find out more about the high-performance benefits, the managed execution, or interop with both Java as the host language and other languages that we run on GraalVM, like C, Ruby, JavaScript, and others, please drop by. I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
And it again looks different. That's how it was supposed to look like. Okay. Hannah Chupan?
Hi, I'm Hannah from Free University of Berlin. And in terms of applications of Python for scientific computing, I'm working on computational chemistry. But actually, I put up a whole bunch of keywords, and I'm happy to talk about all of them. So basically, in the first phase, I deal a lot with rigid body dynamics, with quaternions, rotations, stuff like that, which is quite independent from then the application side, which is kind of discussing how especially these big molecules, proteins, that are important for pharmaceutical engineering or for understanding the processes in our bodies, how they fit together, how they interact, why, and how fast they bind. So if you're interested in any of these keywords, I would be very happy if you either check the GitHub or come around to the poster. I think the green is significant enough that you are going to find it.
Okay. So the next one is Alexander.
Yep. So how do you change the slides? Because
I saw space.
Okay. Not so complicated. Hello, I'm Alexander, and I'm a PhD student at EPFL Lab Cosmo, where we do research like similar as my previous speaker, but a bit more on the atomic scale. And this project, Cycled Widget, was born out of the creation of a course for undergraduate students in material science, who usually don't have such a strong background in coding, so we wanted to reduce this kind of complexity and focus more on the translation of theory, physical theory, chemical theory to code, and the analysis of the results of the experiments. And for that, we use IPy widgets to
have a control over how much code we reveal to the student, and also have an interactivity to control the experimental parameters. So this is the essence of the package of Scikit widget. It's just a code input plus a parameter box plus a visualization, so the student can input its code there, run, and then by pressing on the button, the code is run through with the set parameters, and then it is post-processed by a function the teacher sets into these visualizations at the bottom. And so this should help the teacher to just focus on creating the exercise, not dealing with a bunch of boilerplate code. Yeah, thank you. That was it. You can find me at poster number 15 at the last poster. You can find information if you Google Scikit widgets. You should find the JupyterCon poster. Thank you.